The Treasure at Poldarrow Point, an Angela Marchmont mystery, Book 3. Written by Clara Benson, narrated by Elizabeth Klett. Chapter 1.
What you need, Mrs. Marchmont, said Dr. Wilding, is a holiday. A bout of influenza like the one you've just had is bound to leave you feeling below par. A few weeks of sun and healthy sea air will see you as right as rain.
Angela Marchmont sighed. I dare say you're right, she said. Perhaps I have been overexerting myself.
There's no doubt about it, said the doctor. Fit and healthy people don't tend to faint all over the place, especially not in the royal enclosure.
Don't, said Angela, blushing at the memory. You can't imagine what a fool I felt. And to do it in front of Cynthia Pilkington Soames, too. She won't admit to it, but I have it on good authority that she writes the society gossip column in the Clarion. Now I suppose I shall be all over the papers again. And just when I was hoping for a little peace and quiet.
All the more reason to get away, then. Yes, he went on, you may consider it as doctor's orders.
Where do you suggest I go?
Anywhere you like, so long as it's not London. What about the south coast? Bournemouth, perhaps. Or, if you really want to get away from it all, then Cornwall is the place to go.
I've never been to Cornwall, said Angela thoughtfully. A quiet hotel, or a little cottage by the sea, would be delightful.
A cottage, you say? Said Dr. Wilding. Ah, now if it's a cottage you're talking about, then perhaps I can help. Another patient of mine, Mrs. Uppingham, was telling me just the other day of a house she has down there. She had been going to spend the summer there, but she broke her leg, and so won't be going anywhere for a few weeks at least. I wonder if she'd be interested in renting it to you.
Where is it?
Place called Tregarion, near Penzance. I don't know whether you've heard of it. It's a quaint old fishing village, or used to be at any rate. The artists discovered it a few years ago, and the tourists followed shortly afterwards. Still, I gather from my patient that it hasn't been totally spoilt yet, and is still pretty quiet by comparison with St. Ives and all those other fashionable places.
It sounds the very thing, said Angela. But I'm not sure it will be possible. I'm engaged every evening next week, and after that I promise to go and stay with the Harrisons in Kent for a few days. Then, of course, there's Goodwood, and by that time perhaps Mrs. Uppingham will have recovered and want her house back.
I should have thought you had had enough of racing after that little exhibition of yours at Ascot. Well, I can't make you do it, but I'll be disappointed if you don't. You can't be too careful of your health, you know. We none of us are getting any younger.
By which, I suppose, you mean I am not getting any younger, said Angela dryly. How very tactful of you to put it that way. The doctor grinned unrepentantly.
You are easily in as good a shape as a woman 10 years younger, Mrs. Marchmont. If all my patients were as healthy as you, I should make no money. But you are not 18. You can't simply shake these things off in the same way you should have done 20 years ago.
He glanced at his watch and rose.
Well, I must be going, but do think about what I said.
I shall, said Angela. He nodded and went out. "Shall you go, madame?" said Angela's maid, who had been busying herself silently about the room during the doctor's examination. "I don't know, Marta," said Angela. "I'd like to take a holiday, certainly. But you know what the Harrisons are like. Marguerite goes into such a huff if one cancels a visit. I should have to spend the next 2 years making it up to her. She is like a spoilt child, that one. A little, perhaps. But she is very good company, and I have been promising to go to them since last year. You do too much, madame, said Marta. Everybody wants you,
It is very tiresome. The doctor is right. You have been ill, and should rest yourself.
Marta had firm ideas as to her own influence and importance, which were very nearly correct.
And I shall, replied Angela, only it may have to wait a few weeks until I have the time.
You must make time. It is foolish to be afraid of one's friends in such situations as these.
I am not afraid of Marguerite Harrison, said Angela with dignity. Whatever makes you think I am?
The girl made no reply, but her expression said much. Angela was about to defend herself further, but was saved the trouble when the telephone bell rang. Marta answered it.
Mrs. Pilkington Soames would like to speak to you, she said.
Angela's heart sank. She took the receiver. Hello, Cynthia, she said warily.
Angela, darling, said an excitable, high-pitched voice at the other end of the line. I do hope you're feeling better now. How simply awful for you to faint in front of the king like that!
Angela closed her eyes briefly, but was given no chance to reply.
His Majesty was terribly concerned for you, naturally, but he had to rush off and present the gold cup so he couldn't stay. I did hear that he was asking about you afterwards, though.
Oh, said Angela.
I understand you've been quite ill lately. Is that why you fainted? Of course, we all know about that business at Underwood and how you were attacked. Tell me, was it very dreadful?
Said Angela.
It must have frightened you out of your wits. The papers were full of it all. Is that why we haven't seen you very much recently?
Mrs. Pilkington Soames lowered her voice to a more sympathetic level.
They do say that you had a sort of nervous breakdown afterwards.
That's absolute began Angela, but Cynthia pressed on.
Oh, come now, you can tell me. Why, everyone knows that I am absolutely the last word in discretion. Now, somebody said it was influenza, but you can't fool me, darling. Influenza? At this time of year? Who ever heard of such a thing? But seriously, Angela, I can recommend a tremendously good doctor. Well, I suppose one ought to call him a psychiatrist, really. You remember Naomi McNamara, don't you?
Said Angela.
You know, the one who had that rather unfortunate episode with the gardener's boy. Nymphomania, I think they called it. Well, she saw this Dr. Gambara, or is it Gambetta? I can never remember these foreign names. And he put his hands on her head and chanted something terribly esoteric. And now, of course, she's left her husband and gone off to Scotland to join the Order of the Sisters of Divine Mercy. So you see, he's obviously an expert in matters of the mind.
Ugh, said Angela.
Do remind me to give you his card. Now, darling, said Mrs. Pilkington Soames, suddenly becoming brisk and businesslike, I have something to propose to you.
Oh, yes?
Yes, let me explain. I was at an evening party the other night and just happened to fall into conversation with a terribly clever man, a Mr. Bickerstaff, who, I was quite astonished to discover, turns out to be the editor of the Clarion. Naturally, I know nothing about the business.
Here Angela pulled a disbelieving face.
But he was quite the gentleman, which surprised me, as I had always understood that newspaper people were rather rough.
I see.
Anyhow, went on Mrs. Pilkington Soames, you won't believe it, but while we were talking about this and that, it somehow came out that I knew you. He was terribly excited when he found out, and asked me if there was any chance that I should be able to get an interview with you. Now do say yes, darling.
Are you quite mad? Said Angela, before she could stop herself. Fortunately, Cynthia was not listening and went on.
Why, just think what an enormous scoop it would be for me. You are one of the most famous women in England today, thanks to your recent exploits. The public is simply dying to know everything about you. I thought perhaps I could write about you from a more personal angle, with some photographs. You know what I mean. Mrs. Marchmont relaxing at home, and all that sort of thing. You could give the readers your advice for baking the perfect sponge cake, or something of the kind.
"Baking?" said Angela, aghast.
"Oh, yes, our women readers love all that domestic stuff. When at home, our lady detective puts away her gun and takes up her rolling pin. We could even have a picture of you in a pinny."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.